Hello dear students, I am Pinas Kavrana. Today we will be doing the second chapter of civics, that is understanding secularism. In the previous chapter we saw the basic definition or meaning of what a secular government can be, where we saw that secularism is something where a country is not imposing any particular religion on its citizen. Which means that you, if you are a citizen of our country or of any country, you'll be having all the rights to choose any religion that you want to follow or preach according to your wish. So that is a secular state of government, where the government or the state or the country is not imposing or not asking you to follow a particular religion if you want to stay in that country or place or state or whatsoever. You have all the freedom to choose whatever religion you want to. This was the basic definition of secularism that we understood in the previous chapter. Now in this chapter we'll be having an in-depth understanding about secularism. Plus we will also see that why is secularism very important for a democratic form of government. In the past, if I talk about the past, we could see non-secular government being very popular, and there was a phase where I can, you know, count innumerable examples of a non-secular type of a government. For example, in your textbook only, they have given this example of Hitler. Hitler in Germany, he had killed several millions of Jews. And now, these is a Jewish state of Israel. They treat their own Muslims and Christians very indifferently and very, very cruelly. So, why does all this happen? Why do you think any people or any group of religion in any country have the audacity to do all this, have the audacity to practice all this? Now, if I take the example of our country, can you imagine being a Hindu and treating a Muslim in a very bad or pathetic way? Of course not. You can never be doing that. Even if you have the audacity to do it, and even if you dare to do it, then definitely you will face the consequences by the government of the country. Why this differentiation? This differentiation is because our country is a secular country. Now, in a secular country, we have the right to select any religion that we want to follow or preach. Now, if you were living in a country which was not a secular country, and the country had imposed a particular religion like Christianity or Hinduism, and if you find any Muslims around you or any other religion person, you can of course dominate that particular person. But in a country like India, where we call ourselves as a secular country, we have all the authority, all the rights to follow or preach any religion that we want to. Hence, if I am a Hindu and if I see a Christian person, I cannot dominate him. Why? Because my country is a secular country, and that person, though he is in minority, he has all the rights for himself also, because he is the citizen of the country and he cannot be mistreated or ill-treated by me. Okay, so what is basically secularism? Secularism basically refers to a state where the power of religion is separated from the power of state. I repeat, this could be point one. Secularism refers to a state where the power of religion is separated from the power of state. This point means that it is a condition in the state, in the country, where the state cannot interfere in the religious matters of its citizens, which means that the state has given the liberty to its citizens to select any religion that they want to follow or preach, or they want to exit, or they want to adopt. Okay, so basically the citizens of the country in a secular state are always going to have the power to select the religion of what they want to. So this is what is secularism. Now, the Indian Constitution also allows individuals the freedom to live by their religious beliefs and practices as they interpret these. Now, as I have said, as we are clear about the meaning of secularism, that you have the power to choose any religion that you want to. ओके सो दिस प्रॉब्लम इज सॉर्टेड ओवर हियर. इफ यू आर सिटीजन ऑफ आर कंट्री यू कैन बी अ हिंदू मुस्लिम क्रिश्चियन सिख वॉट्सो एवर एंड यू विल बी ट्रीटेड इक्वली. बट दिस अनदर थिंग इज ऑल्सो वेरी रेलिवेंट इन आर कंट्री, नॉट नाउ बट इट वॉज अर्लियर, दैट इवन इफ यू आर अ हिंदू देर आर सम मेजॉरिटी ग्रुप्स इन द हिंदू रिलीजन इट सेल्फ who always try to dominate the other Hindus in a very bad way. They come up with certain cultures and rules and regulations and they want every Hindu to follow it. Now you are a different person, you have a different mindset. It might be possible that something that is right to them is not right to them, not right to you. For example, the untouchability practice. Maybe untouchability practice was right to some of the Hindus, but it was very bad to you felt that untouchability was something very wrong and you wanted to stop it, otherwise you at least did not want to follow it. Now what used to happen earlier was these majority of Hindus who thought that this is our culture or this is something is right and this has to be followed, they used to always dominate the minorities. So the government has also come up with this solution and the government has started interfering and making laws so that the minorities of the same religion can also be protected by the majorities. All right. Next topic is, why is it important to separate religion from state? The second point here can be, if the majority religious group gets state power, then it can lead to discrimination or even killing of the minorities. Third point could be, secularism is important for a country to function democratically. Fourth, to avoid the tyranny of the majority that can cause violation of fundamental rights, separation of state and religion is important in democratic societies. So till now, whatever we have understood, I could get these four points for you. Now we'll go to the next topic, that is, why is it important to separate religion from state? Okay, as we have discussed that secularism, the basic concept of secularism is to separate religion from state. Okay. Now, why is this important? This is important because if the state is imposing a particular religion on the state or the country, then the people of that particular religion, they come in majority. And these majority group of people or religion can cause harm to the ones who are in minority. So this can be the first reason why it is very important for the state to separate its power from the religion. Okay. Second thing is that these majorities, they can start dominating, they can be very cruel, they can even lead to the killing of the minorities, which we have discussed in the point earlier. And all these things can lead to huge destructions. And that is why it is very important for the important to have separation of power separation of power between state and religion. Sorry. Second, another important reason that it is important to separate religion from the state is because we also need to protect freedom of individuals to exit a particular religion. Okay, the second reason, first reason we saw that it was very important to have separate powers of state and religion is because the majorities do not start dominating the minorities and become harmful on them. The second important reason is everybody should have the freedom of choosing their religion. Okay, this also we have seen in the earlier explanation that every person living in the country or being a citizen of the country should have all the rights to select whatever religion they want to select. And so the second reason is freedom of people who wish to select their religion by themselves. Here the fifth point could be, secularism is important also because we should provide freedom to individuals to choose एनी रिलीजन और एग्जिट एनी रिलीजन और टू हैव फ्रीडम टू इंटरप्रेट रिलीजन्स डिफरेंटली. ओके, इन दिस फिफ्थ पॉइंट आई विल री रीड द लास्ट लाइन, दैट इज फ्रीडम टू इंटरप्रेट रिलीजन्स डिफरेंटली. I need to explain this. With this, we can understand that I had earlier taken the example of untouchability. In the example of untouchability, what did we see? That, for example, there are 10 people of 10 Hindus in a particular country. Out of those 10, 6 are following untouchability. 6 are in favor of untouchability. They feel that minorities should be treated badly or they should not be touched or whatsoever. They follow untouchability. Only the 4 Hindus are such who have a different mindset, a modern mentality, and so they feel that untouchability is something wrong and it should be stopped. Alright? Now, of course, when these 4, they are the minorities, they'll have a pressure from the majority, okay? And this majority can create harm, then can cause harm to the minorities. So, in our constitution, we also have this right that you can have any interpretation or meaning of the religion that you are following. Which means that it is not necessary that if you are a Hindu and if 6 Hindus out of 10 are following untouchability, then you are also bound to follow untouchability. If you want, you can stop untouchability. If you want, you can avoid that. If you want, you can go get on and change the customs also. Okay. So this is what the last line meant, that you have the freedom to interpret religions differently. For example, if we see a very relevant example in our country, we have Muslims all around. Now Muslims, I will never say that all of them are the same. Correct? We have always been seeing this, that some majority are, you know, they are very genuine, they are nice people, okay? They are they will never do something bad for the country or with the people of the country. They have a different interpretation of their religion, whereas some have a different interpretation of their religion, and so they practice some ill concepts. Okay, moving on. What is Indian secularism? Now, Indian secularism, what is Indian secularism? Here you can see that Indian constitution mandates that the Indian state be secular. According to the constitution, only a secular state can realize its objectives to ensure the following. First, that one religious community does not dominate other. That some members do not dominate other members of the same religion. That the state does not enforce any particular religion nor take away the religious freedom of individuals. So what is Indian secularism? Indian secularism, as we have discussed throughout the chapter, and that is 3 points are there to consider Indians as the secularist. Okay, the first one is any religion or community does not dominate any other community. Okay, no domination of majority and no oppression of the minority. Second, the state will not impose any particular religion on anybody. You as a citizen have all the authority to follow the religion that you want to. Third, some members of the same community cannot dominate the other members. Okay, so these are the 3 things. Now, the Indian state works in various ways to prevent the above domination. Now, all the 3 points that I mentioned here in this topic, the Indian constitution has 3 steps in it, 3 ways by which all the 3 points that I mentioned earlier in this topic, you can see on your screen, can be stopped or prevented. First is, it uses a strategy of distancing itself from religion. Now, the Indian constitution has very clearly mentioned that the government will always distance itself from the religion. For example, if you go through this case study, you will see that here is a government school and some students wanted to celebrate some religious festival. The school said no because it was a government school. Now, distancing from religion means that any government institute or school or place cannot have any religious celebrations or anything like that. Even if you go to a police station or a court, you will never find boards or banners of Hinduism or, you know, some Hindu leaders. Okay, why? Because these government places are strictly not ever going to stay connected on any religious grounds. This means that they will always distance themselves from any particular religion. Okay, now in any this there is also a law where the government schools in the country can never have any religious festivals or celebrations in their school. Why? Because they have to distance themselves from one particular religion. For example, if a government school is celebrating Ganesh Chaturthi and is not celebrating Eid, then again it is against the Indian constitution, because in a secular state one should never be supporting a particular religion. So all the government schools or institutions, they will always distance themselves from a particular religion. This is the first step to adhere to secularism. Second step is that the state adopts a theory of non-interference. Now, this second step is also very important, where the state is also where the state is never going to have any sort of interference in the religious theories. For example, in the case study, we have two people who are riding on a bike. One is a Sikh and one is a non-Sikh. The person who is not a Sikh is wearing a helmet, whereas the person who is a Sikh is not wearing a helmet and is telling that for him, wearing a turban is very important according to his religion, and so he will not be wearing a helmet. The government has also made an exception for all the Sikhs, and the that wearing turban is more important to them in their religion, and so they will never be fined for not wearing a helmet. Now this exception is only for the Sikh people. So by this way, by this exception, we can see that how the government has adopted a theory of non-interference in the personal matters of religion. All right, so this was the second thing. Now the third point is the strategy of intervention in religion based personal laws of communities. This is very important. Here what the government does is, if the government is seeing that a particular religion is imposing certain evil practices on its own religion, for example the untouchability example that I had given you in the beginning of the chapter, if the government sees that such ill practices are going on in a particular religion by the members of the religion itself, then the government has all the rights to put interventions. That is, the government will make laws or rules or regulations by which those people who are enforcing, who are forcing their fellow religion members to follow some ill practices are stopped. Okay, so these were the three points by which secularism can be followed. Here point number six can be made, and that is, to adhere to secularism, the Indian government carries on the following steps. First, it distances itself from any one religion. Second, the state adopts a theory of non-interference. Third is the strategy of intervention in religion-based personal laws of communities. Now, the final topic of our chapter is, why do you think the Indian secularism is different from other secular countries? Some of the above objectives are similar to those that have been included in the constitution of secular democratic countries in other parts of the world. For example, First Amendment of US Constitution prohibits legislature from making laws respecting an establishment of religion, or that prohibit the first exercise of religion. What is meant by establishment? There is one significant way in which Indian secularism differs from the dominant understanding of secularism as practiced in the United States of America. This is because, unlike the strict separation of religion and the state in American secularism, Indian secularism can always intervene in religious affairs. Okay, so the last topic is, why do you think our secularism is different from the other countries' secularism? The third point that we discussed earlier about intervention, that is the only different way that we are following in our secular form of government. In other countries, if you see that when they have said that the state will never interfere in the matters of the this religion, they will actually not, but our country has this exception and they make interventions whenever they find it necessary. If they see any evil practices going on in a particular religion amongst themselves, then definitely the state will come up, make some interventions and change some laws or impose some new laws and stop that evil practice. This is obviously a very positive point, and it is a very important thing to maintain peace and equality in the country. From this, we can come to point number 7. That is, one way in which Indian secularism is different is that it can intervene in religious matters if fundamental rights of people are being violated. Last point is, however, any interference in religion by state should be based on its ideals laid in the constitution only. Okay, when I say that my country is different, it has a different way of following secularism, it also means that the country will never go against whatever is mentioned or stated in the constitution. It will always adhere to all the ideals laid down in the constitution of the country only. All right, so with this we are done with the chapter. I hope you have understood the basic concept of secularism, and you have now also you are also aware about why secularism is very important for a democratic form of government. Thank you.